There was fire that you could see from outside the hospital, across the entire Adelaide Hills, ambulances coming in frequently, no idea of the number of trauma that was coming in, no idea of the number of burns victims. It was relentless. For days and weeks, I was seconded not only to the intensive care unit where I worked as my sort of day job, but also to the burns unit, the ER, the trauma room, etc. Extra shifts, double shifts, as much work as anyone could get out of all of the staff, and it was absolutely relentless. Many deaths, many people injured, and burns victims have really complicated injuries and recovery. At the same time, there was also everything else that comes into the hospital and comes into the ICU. So major trash, major trauma from all sorts of other things coming into the ICU as well. You're managing all of that. For those that don't know Australia, it's a large country. Most of the population's all around the coast. So for us to go and get intensive care people from around the remote areas, we have to use helicopter, fixed wing, Hercules, flying doctor, etc., etc. So I live in Adelaide, which is in the middle down the bottom, those don't know Australia. So we deployed both road ambulance and helicopter to pick up these victims and bring them back to the big tertiary referral hospital where I was working. It was just, as I said, relentless and relentless on the staff. So choppers again, and this is the next one is the, here we are, this is the Royal Flying Doctor. So you're basically going out in concentric circles, road ambulance, helicopter, fixed wing, Hercules, et cetera, and then commercial aircraft when you take people overseas. So fast forward, as well, we're involved in also people from our unit going off to international disasters. This is a picture back from the Indonesian tsunami, you might remember back in 2005. You can recognise Colin Powell there, many of you are from this country, of course, and the fellow on Colin Powell's right is my brother, Bill Griggs, who was a wing commander in Air Force Reserve and also an intensivist. That'll be relevant later on. So one of the problems with all of this work, relentless as it is burnout. And this is a great quote about burnout. Primarily the result of healthcare systems that take emotionally healthy, altruistic people and methodically squeeze the vitality and passion out of them. And I guess, you know, if you think about COVID, what that did, you can all relate to that because people didn't know what intensive care was and now the whole sort of world really understands that whole world. Burnout's everywhere. This is Boston Globe. Lovely to see you, Mary Jo, at the back there. A fine, fine journalist, and wherever you look, you can find articles all around burnout. Consequences, there's all sorts of things that you can that will impact healthcare systems, patient care, physician health, nursing health, etc. Relentless, as I said, affects junior, seniors, and mostly physicians. If you look at some of the data, who's the most burnt out? Intensive care, emergency physicians are top of the tree, and you can sort of understand why. It's not rocket science data, really. So how can we improve, how can we use AI to improve some functional systems in the trauma room that might then be able to impact on burnout and a systemised way of functioning? There's lots of applications of AI in healthcare, lots of ones are emerging. You've seen lots of things around protocols being used, assistants, lots of agents, etc. And if you think about, this is Ramesh Raskar's quote at the bottom, AI needs to be where the puck is going, not where it is now. And we're seeing these models and things change so fast. And of course, a famous, for those of you who know Wayne Gretzky, a famous quote by him about go where the puck's going. So what functional systems do you think we could play with in the emergency room to try and make it more efficient with less burnout? So just the schematic here, you don't have to worry about the detail. Suffice to say that in the emergency room, when there's a major trauma that comes in, whether it's a burns victim or other, there's a lot of people that go into the room to do a whole bunch of things, whether that's radiology, whether that's taking tests, whether that's assessing the patient, whether that's triaging, whatever it might be, it's a complicated team. A lot of voice commands, a lot of voice prompts, a lot of protocols, and varying levels of skill in the room. So what if we could take this, supercharge it with AI, with the advent of voice recognition, and triangulate that data by using voice recognition, by using sensors, cameras, colour code the staff, and then be able to visually represent what's happening in that room up on the screen. What if you could import all the protocols, have them on screen, so that the voice commands then fill the gaps, and then you can see what's missing and who does what next. And that's all doable now with AI, and that's one of the things I'm working on. Of course, as a verb, I'm using world-class as a verb here. World-class your team early. So this is my brother, who you saw earlier in that photograph. A trauma doctor and intensivist of, you know, worldwide acclaim. So he and I have been looking at this trauma room situation to work out how could you really leverage this AI to be able to do this smartly, functionally, and by doing that, reducing some of the burnout, reducing some of the pressure, reducing some of the load within that trauma room. Now, you can always clone yourself, that's another thing. In fact, I've already done that because I've got an identical twin, and as you can see here, the only defining point of difference is the colour of the handbags. So you want to try and recruit whoever you can recruit, but cloning is opposite, not quite so relevant now. So just again, just a schematic. So emergency rooms really rely on coordinated functions, coordinated timing to get best practice outcome, the right treatment at the right time. Now you could just have the protocols listed up on the wall and you could say, well, here's the protocol for the particular trauma that you have. But actually it's the decision-making about when to apply that protocol, how to apply it, and who should apply it to get the best outcome at the best time, to get the best result for the patient. So what about workforce? So we've talked about burnout and we've talked about how we might operationally improve the trauma room. And what can we do about workforce? If we take skill and we match it to the patient acuity of the on the other side, how sick the patient is, if you get a mismatch, you get a risk of adverse event, you have more cost, the patient suffers, and there's complications for the patient having a longer length of stay. I did a PhD on this back in the day, and now I'm taking that PhD and taking it and AIing it, if that's the right word. So it's a complicated set of inputs when you're trying to work out your matching of your skill set. How do you match that to patient acuity? But now with AI, what we're going to do is automate that. The communications, the skill matching, the skill of the staff to the patient acuity of the patient, the competencies of the staff using some proprietary stuff from my PhD. And then imagine if you automated all of the comms. So you didn't have staff wearing out the rosters. It was all automated and automatically communicated with all the staff. So the rosters were built in an automated way without people having to sit there with spreadsheets and time and task. Reducing burnout, reducing cost by 10x on our figures, and reducing adverse events. That's where if you mismatch incorrectly, you get a bad outcome. One of the challenges is building AI systems from scratch. A whole bunch of things here about expertise, how you might go about that, and also how you're going to stay current. So one of the biggest challenges with AI is the speed of which these models and systems are coming through. So the ability to understand what's coming next, so where the puck is going, is really, really important. And that's one of the biggest challenges that we've got at the minute.